went to see Black Panther, which is amazing. You've heard this and you've dealt with this avalanche of attention. I'm not going to tire you out. You've answered these questions.
I'm not tired of hearing that.
Okay, all right. Apart from the box office, just the impact culturally, you know. But I went to see it under the guidance of my son, Henry, who's a comic book encyclopedia. He has many, probably hundreds of thousands of comics. They're stacked to the ceiling all over the house. And he draws, he writes stories. He's into the mythology of every single, not every single, but many comic book storylines. And your storyline, Black Panther, was one he was really interested in seeing. And so I had a professor of comic book lore and Wakanda mythology, everything. You know, he took me by the hand, and it was great seeing it with him. But I was in, you know, you've got all these, obviously you must have done a lot of green screen, a lot of, your director Ryan Coogler, he had to handle a lot, you know, as much stuff as Peter Jackson did on Lord of the Rings, and still try to get heartfelt performances, you know, defined characters. And what I really admired as much as anything was the way you listen. Mm. You know, to me, the foundation of good acting is always good reacting. But not just there, you do that in your other roles that I've seen too, as Thurgood Marshall, as Jackie Robinson, you know, James Brown. You have an ability, even when you're in motion, even when you're in action, you're very attentive, it seems to me, to your environment, no matter what genre you're in. And I love that about your work.
I saw Green Book last night. I had a link in it, and it finally worked last night. Mm-hmm. But I knew your work from Lord of the Rings, Captain Fantastic. I told you yesterday, I could watch that movie over and over and over again.
We had fun.
I was like, you know what? I was like, the character has issues because he's raising his kids this way, but I love the way he's doing it. Like, I want to put some of that in my life. Hmm. So the character itself is something that I, you know, revere.
Thank you.
And so, even though that is something that's not, it may not be your exact life, but I think it inspires people to think about the world in a different way. So I just love that movie. I was intrigued by the idea of you playing an Italian American.
I was intrigued. I was terrified. Well, you must have been terrified playing Thurgood Marshall.
Yeah.
James Brown. I mean, these are...
I think we're always terrified, you know?
Yeah, always a little. If you're not scared, something's wrong.
Something's
right?
wrong, yeah. Yeah.
But when you're playing a historical figure, you know, I mean, I'm playing a guy who existed, Tony Vallelonga, and it's not like people have a clear, as anywhere near publicly, you know, at large, an image of that person. You know, he has lots of friends, lots of family. But Jackie Robinson, James Brown, you have something. I mean, the weird thing is when you're playing someone who really existed, that there's photographs of, that there's film of in some cases.
Everybody can judge it.
Yeah,
everybody,
and you know you're never going to be, you're never going to look exactly like the person. Mm-hmm. You're trying to, I guess, capture the essence of that person, right? I mean, mm-hmm. You're trying to understand the character so you can play him, and hopefully you want people that see it to understand and not judge the person. But there is a certain, I don't know about you, but like for the character in Green Book, Tony Vallelonga, I got a lot of help once I got over being a coward and said, okay, I'll do it.
From the family?
From the family. They really helped me. But the more of them I met, the more help I got, but the more I thought I better get this right, because this means a lot to them. And to all the friends. And then the other day we had a sort of a breakthrough moment. We had a screening in outside of New York City in Rye, New York. It's a big, big screen, big hall. And it was family and friends, right?
Wow.
And the people, we went out to do a Q&A with the director and stuff. And it was all these, like a lot of big guys and all Italian American. And it's like half the cast of The Sopranos and then some like real Sopranos. I don't even want to know what they're... daily life is, but they were all like in suits and with the chains and the hair slicked back and just looking real serious like that. And then when we came on stage, And then the lights come up, and I could see the faces. Some of them had tears in their eyes, and some of them, and then they came forward, and it was hugs and all that. And I'm thinking, thank God.
Yeah.
Because what if it had not been okay? Did you have any of that within any of these historical characters?
I had all of that. I think my initial meeting with Rachel Robinson, I was terrified. Mm-hmm. She basically said, I wanted Sidney Poitier and Denzel Washington. And
she told you that?
She told me that. Mm-hmm. And, that puts a lot of
pressure.
A whole lot of pressure. I think with Get On Up, playing James Brown, the family, they do their own imitations of him.
They imitate dance moves, everything.
but especially, the voice and things that he would say, and because they miss him.
Sure.
And when you see them do it, it's like they sort of at times wanted me to like show them, how are you going to do this? And I would always be like, nah, I want to hold that off.
You're not ready yet.
Yeah. And so I think the time that you spend with them is one where you have to walk this very thin line.
Respectful.
Because I knew that I didn't want to imitate him because I didn't want to offend. I wanted to find the essence of him and not
right.
the cat. Yeah, exactly. And I actually heard you say that yesterday. Like, you briefly said that word. I want to make sure I'm not doing a caricature.
Mm-hmm.
And when I watched you, I was like, dude, I was like, are you sure? I had to look up your Wikipedia. Are you sure you're not Italian? Like, like, are you sure? I thought it was astounding, like amazing what you did.
I had a great partner on it too. Yeah. I mean, we had it's really well written, but two guys in a car, mm-hmm. it could be dull. It doesn't matter how many angles you shoot it, unless you got a connection with that other. I mean, it's a great ensemble cast, but with Mahershala, that had to work. We had to connect, and fortunately, we really did,
Hey, when I was in the army, I know a guy from Pittsburgh. Except he called it Pittsburgh. But he said all the women there had huge tits.
That's absurd.
Guess we'll find out, huh?
I saw you in Captain Fantastic and Lord of the Rings, and you were in great shape. In great, great, condition, mm-hmm. You're climbing the mountain in Captain Fantastic,
mm-hmm.
and shirt off and everything. And in this, I said, how much did he have to eat?
Well, that was...
Before, but even during the film, how much did you eat?
Well, it turned out that, I guess you could do it these days the way they do the fat suits and what they can do. But if I hadn't done that, if I hadn't gained a lot of weight, I gained a lot of weight. That was the easy part. You're just eating. And then you got to keep eating. That was not so much fun. Because in the wardrobe, I'd spend the weekend during the shoot and I'd go back to normal eating, not like, three dinners and, all the desserts.
Right.
I'd just have dinner and then go to, and then I get there on Monday and they'd go, you've lost a half inch on your belt. And I'm like, you got to go back to eating what you were, to keep it up. But that was the easy part. The thing that was good about having done that, as it turned out on a practical level, was that you expand your stomach when you get heavy. Your stomach's getting bigger.
Yeah,
there's no way I could have done those scenes. When you think about it, you see a lot of eating on screen
in the movie.
But there's more than one take.
And
there's
know.
More than one angle.
I was like,
I could have fit that in.
Yeah, you couldn't have, like, you have an eating contest.
Oh, the hot dog thing.
The chicken scene.
It was ridiculous. All the time, all the time.
Oh, and I was like, you can tell the way it's shot that those are different takes on top of each other when you're pulling it, which is great. Like, it's one of those moments where the continuity actually, if you have continuity, it works against like how much the audience feels you're eating in the scene.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I was intrigued by that the whole time. I was like, oh, he's gonna eat the whole pizza now. Amazing.
There was a lot. Well,
that's commitment. You say it's easy. I don't know if I could do it.
Well, yeah. Just gaining the weight before was easier than figuring out how to be an Italian American. Well, when I watch Black Panther, I've done movies where you have to do lots of stunts, and then, you know, they have, there's this sort of thing between what's practical for stunts and what the look is of the character, right? You know, and you always try to get as comfortable as you can. And, you know, when I was in Lord of the Rings, there were certain, it looked cool sometimes, but it wasn't the most comfortable to run down a mountain or have a fight. And there was like a little adjustments you make with the soles of the boots or the, you know, and how heavy is the sword and what do you do? And like that chainmail may look cool, but after about, you know, 50 takes all night long, you start to get tired. Or the leather stuff, it gets wet in the rain. And but you have this outfit that's really cool as Black Panther. Right. But I'm thinking you got this mask on, you got this really tight thing. Right. It must have been restrictive. How did you prepare to, like, because you got to do some intensely physical things in that, right?
Yeah, the funny thing about it is when you say that there's a body for the stunts and then there's a body for, you know, for the look. And in this, Michael and I have our shirts off. It was a very interesting process, and it's a day-to-day thing. Very intricate. And I had two trainers. I had a trainer for martial arts, Maurice Crump, and I had a conditioning coach, Addison Henderson.
Like lift weights.
Lifting weights, also still some stretching, cardio. You know, with Maurice, it was all different styles. Capoeira, Hari Mao, Muay Thai, Jiu-Jitsu, Aikido, like Kali, a lot of weapons. So
my son does martial arts.
Zulu stick fighting,
and
all kinds of stuff.
Talking about all these things, I have no idea.
He was
breaking it down. He goes, he's doing that, and that move is this, and that move.
So intense. But that body to do those physical things is one thing. And also to be able to do it in the suit with the restrictions. It's like you're wearing resistance bands while you run and while you move.
But what about your vision with that mask?
You know, sometimes you have the whole thing on, sometimes you don't, and they can put parts of it in.
Were you asking to have it off sometimes?
Anytime you can, you want to have it off. But there's certain times when you can't. No. And so it's being able to breathe with that. So you're wearing elevation masks when you work out. You're jumping rope for 30 minutes with an elevation mask, or running 3 miles with the elevation mask, or sprints.
To make you more resistant.
Yeah, so that you can deal with all of the pressure that the suit is putting on your body. And so the other thing about it is, you know, when you have your clothes off, you have to lift more weights. When you have the suit on, you want to be as like agile and slim as you can. So you do different workouts on different days.
Knowing what's coming up that week.
Yeah, but if you're in the water and you have to have your clothes off, you work out to be seen, but then now that you've worked out, you still got to do all the stunts in the water. So you've tired yourself out and now you have to fight the whole day.
Was Michael Jordan, was he a good like dance partner?
Yeah, absolutely.
In that sense?
Yeah. You know, it was one of those things, like, they did a documentary on Ric Flair recently. I think it was, I don't know if it was ESPN or HBO, but it was ESPN because it was a 30 for 30. But it's sort of like that. You're playing with each other.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, you can't look good fighting somebody if they don't take the fall. And you have to play in that way. So it is definitely a dance.
Right.
All of that is stuff that you prepare beforehand and that you have to, you know, you have to have a sensitivity towards each other beforehand.
My name is King T'Challa, son of King T'Chaka. I am the sovereign ruler of the nation of Wakanda. And for the first time in our history, we will be sharing our knowledge and resources with the outside world.
I mean, we had that on Green Book. It's a different thing. It's not stunts. It's the reaction.
Yes.
And the thing that makes some of those moments really funny, you know, where I say I don't censor myself as this character at all, you know, is Mahershala's reactions. His reactions are, and then my reaction to that. I don't understand his reaction. You know, it goes like the scene where we're in the diner, you know, that was the first time we looked at each other. The first week we were shooting, I'm sitting in front.
He's
in the back, and where the rear view is, which is what I'm looking at, because every time I turn around, he goes, "Eyes on the road, Tony," and I'm like, So I can only see him in the rear view. But really, the camera was there for a two shot where they'd rack to him, rack to me.
Right.
So I wasn't seeing him for the
first
Very week.
Tough.
And he was looking at the back of my head. So Very we had tough. Lost one of our senses, sight, mm-hmm. which what that did is it forced us to listen harder. It sharpened, you know, because I had to rely on his tone of voice, how long the pause was. Is he making fun of me? What's going on? You know what I mean? But I couldn't see it. Mm-hmm. And then a week later, we do this scene in the diner where I'm saying about the orphans, Orpheus, and how's the food salty and, you know, mm-hmm. Pittsburgh, all that stuff. And he's just going, just little things. But he was killing me. And I thought, it's a good thing that first week wasn't looking at him because I couldn't have got through a scene without right. laughing. It was, like, very precise.
How difficult was it, you know, the first scene when you guys looked at each other, like, since you said that, you know, because I can literally feel that distance. Mm-hmm. I can feel the distance between you. And it's uncomfortable. Like, I'm sitting there watching it as a layperson and also as a person that does it. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, wow, like, I can literally feel that distance.
Awkwardness.
Yeah, the awkwardness of it. And so did the director delay, how long did he delay the scenes where you're...
Getting to know each other.
Yeah.
As it worked out, I mean, movies, you don't ever, hardly ever shoot in sequence because it's just too expensive, you know, location, unless it all takes place in one room or something. Mm-hmm. But what I liked is that, I mean, to me it's a story, among other things, it's about getting past the limitations of first impressions. Your mm-hmm. first impression of any person that ever lived and ever will live, doesn't matter what color they are, where they're from, what they look like, what they sound like. Every person's different. You can't just, I meet you, I go, oh, I know what kind of guy he is, just from what he's wearing, how he sounds. No, that's just the first impression. Mm-hmm. And this story is about that. And, you know, I think that Doc Shirley's first impression of Tony is, this guy's an idiot. And he's crude, and he's offensive, and he just doesn't shut up. And it's like he's used to having a driver who doesn't talk unless he's asked a question, right? Mm-hmm. And so he's thinking, this is going to be a long trip. If I didn't need this guy, there's no way I would go on a two-month road trip with him. And my first impression is this guy's boring. He doesn't like to talk about family. He's emotionally closed off. It's going to be a long trip. Mm-hmm. And then we gradually learn, you know? And so in the beginning, it is awkward. It's like... And my character doesn't care. I mean, I've played a lot of characters, and I like doing this, who hide their true identity. Sometimes they completely have a different name, whatever. I find that interesting because I think we all do that. Unless you're a person that we like to call insane, but maybe they're the most sane people in the world, who say and do whatever they comes to their mind, mm-hmm. and run screaming down the street, you know. And we go, oh, that's a crazy person. Maybe they're not. Maybe they're just, like, being honest. But I think that each person we meet, depending on the circumstances and what we have at stake in that encounter, we modify the persona we present. It's just a survival thing that everybody does. Mm-hmm. So I like playing those characters. With Tony Lip in Green Book, he's the character I've played who's probably does that the least. He's just like, says whatever he thinks at all times, which is appalling at first to a guy like Doc Shirley, who's like very...
Well, he's had, for his entire life, he's had to make those changes based upon his environment.
Yeah.
You know, he's dealing, you know, there's the fact that his sexuality, his, you know, race, his education, mm-hmm. all of them make him a fish out of water in every place
yeah.
that he's in. So
exactly.
It's amazing to watch these two people who have totally different perspectives mm-hmm. about how to survive. How they relate to the world and surviving in that way
True.
Socially. You know, we have to get to this.
Yeah. Can I was just thinking something about Black Panther. Can I just throw it out there? And then when we were talking earlier about, you know, fans, when you're playing a historical figure,
yeah.
in my case, the family members of Tony Vallon and this and that, yeah. you've played Jackie Robinson, you played Thurgood Marshall, you played James Brown, you played icons, and people have very strong opinions about how they should look, how they should sound, et cetera. So you carry that, and then it's like you gather all the information you can from everybody's opinions, whether you agree or not. Then you gotta put it aside and you gotta play it mm-hmm. And make it your own. It's no different with these fantasy things. You know, there are comic book fans, including my son, who have a very definite idea of how you can get it right, mm-hmm. more or less, or how you can get it really wrong with Black Panther or The Lord of the Rings. Mm-hmm. You know, there, I think, I didn't know this world until we started presenting the trilogy, and people had very, so good thing you guys did this and that. I'm like, okay, I'm glad you like it, you know. But people have very definite opinions, as if they were real historical family. People.
Yeah,
right?
I know.
Did you encounter that with Black Panther? People saying you got that right, or?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I encountered it before I ever did it, and I definitely encountered it after. You know, people saying it should be this way, even before it started. I think.
Even down to the outfit, right?
Down to the outfit, down to body. Like, what should your body look like when you should gain weight, speech, all of it. But I think the thing for me that was the, I guess, the compass for me was I wanted to make sure that there was the most truthful representation of African culture that we could do in a movie like this with the country that's not real. With the past that's
not
real.
But you had a lot of actors from Africa in the movie too, right?
We did, but because I'm not there,
right?
And because I had to start this separate from them. I had to start it in Civil War. You know, I had to make sure that, okay, what is this guy going to sound like if he has an accent? And that was a thing that was not necessarily well received at first by the filmmakers and the producer, because they were afraid of, you know, what is an audience
That you would sound too foreign.
Yeah, what is an audience going to
people
to
love that
to think about? Yeah,
I love watching it.
Yeah, but they didn't.
In Lord of the Rings, they were saying, I kept saying, let's do more Elvish. Let's do more, you know, this language,
exactly,
because it'll make people feel like they're like.
Exactly.
Eavesdropping on something.
Well, they lean in.
It makes it real.
They lean into it because they're like, oh, I've never heard that before. But
they were nervous about it. They said, then we got to subtitle that language.
Yeah.
I said, it's okay. People love that.
People love it.
And then they gradually put a little more and a little more because they realized it worked on the first one.
But. Yeah. So it was a thing of, you know, for me, how do I find that sense of culture? You know, how do I, you know, grab for my own history and past and DNA, and I used everything I could, you know what I'm saying, from doing a few DNA tests.
To find out where you came from.
Exactly where I came from, you know.
South Carolina.
Before South Carolina. and, you know, playing the drums, African dance, incorporating African dance into the fighting, you know, you know, even using my, like, because in a certain sense, I had to realize that I come from a big family, mm-hmm. On my mom's side and my father's side. And we operate in a lot of ways. Once I started to look at cultures, I said, oh, we actually operate like a village. Mm-hmm. You know, the women in my family, all my mom's sisters, they sit around a circle table, mm-hmm. and discuss what's going to happen in the family, or what's going to happen month to month, week to week. Mm-hmm. The men have their place where they conference, and that's very similar to the way, you know, African cultures operate. There's a road where a lot of my family live. They live in a village. Mm-hmm. And so that I had to find those things and realize, oh, we're actually still doing things that we would do anyway. We just don't know we're doing them. And so it was... Those
you're
things
adding
are,
your life experience to the research you're doing.
To the research, exactly.
That's the way you fuse it.
It liberates you and inspires you to because you can pull from actual things that are happening in your life and on certain days and put that in the film. People don't know what you're thinking and feeling.
No, they don't have to.
They don't have
they
to.
They just know it's something real that you're feeling. There was something else that's beyond or that unites cultures, and that's... There was a line in the movie that... Wakabi, is that Daniel Kaluuya's character?
Yep.
Wakabi, right?
Yep.
Is that how you say it?
Yep.
He says at one point, he's arguing, he's like more militant about, you know, we got to keep, this is our stuff and, you know, whatever, protect Wakanda and so forth. I think he's the one that says... Mm-hmm.
Because he's bored of tribe.
Sees the outside pressure, you know, the world outside. He says, if we let, and it just, this echoed for me, in what's going on in this country now, and this fear of people who are different, fear of what the country's made of, immigrants and all that. He goes, if we let refugees into Wakanda, they will bring their problems with them, and then Wakanda will be like everywhere else. I mean, it almost sounded like the current president of the United States talking.
Right.
It's like, it's an understandable, I don't think he's sincere, it's just for political things, but there are people who genuinely feel that in this country, mm-hmm. and in Europe, and all over the place. There's this pressure, and the worse that climate change is gonna affect migration all over the place, and there's gonna be more and more refugees, and we're gonna have to come to grips with the fact that people are gonna go where they can find work,
exactly.
where they can find food.
Well, they can find weather that they can live in.
And if there isn't there, they're gonna go somewhere else that needs it. And we gotta get over this building walls thing. It's in the long run for humanity, it's not gonna work. Mm-hmm. But that was interesting that Wakabi says that line. It was like, wow, it sounded like current events. You know, this is a fantasy movie, and there's some lines like that in Lord of the Rings that have to do with people uniting and different species, different races, finding a way to coexist, which is what we have to do in the long run. Otherwise, humanity is done, you know? And that issue about refugees that's so important right now came up very interestingly in your script, too.
It was amazing to start Black Panther because I remember we were prepping for the movie when the elections happened. Mm. When we literally went
2016.
We literally were, you know, like, okay, tomorrow, you know, Hillary will be president-elect.
Right.
And then had a few people say, I don't know. And the next morning, you're like, oh my gosh.
We're dealing with this now.
This happened. Yeah. Like,
right.
And through the course of, through the course of filming, the script was already, it was already written. Those lines were already in there. I think there's certain things about how this movie was topical. It's unbelievable at times, that the synchronicity
with what's
happening. And we literally went in, I think, and we were like, well, can we keep that line? Well, we have to keep it because it's true to it. We fought for those things to happen. And then I'm just grateful that the studio stood behind the fact that, yeah, this has to be here. This is Wakanda's, mm-hmm. this is the story even in the comic book. You know,
yeah.
The borders is an issue, even in the comic book. But that's also Coogler, you know, making sure that the border tribe was, because it didn't have to be border tribe, mm-hmm. you know, mining tribe. It didn't have to be broken down that way. But he fought for those things because he realized that was important.
It made it real.
I mean,
we could lose our way of life.
Wakanda is strong enough to help others and protect ourselves at the same time.
If you are not so stubborn, you would make a great queen.
I would make a great queen because I am so stubborn.
If that's what I wanted.
How was Ryan Coogler with you guys just on a day-to-day? How was it working with him? I mean, he was under a lot of pressure, big budget, time crunch, all that, right?
What I love about it, him, is that he doesn't lose, and you can speak to this too, you know, he doesn't lose what makes him work well as an indie filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
While he's doing a big budget movie.
Right.
And Marvel, I would say, they actually are looking for the indie filmmaker to make their movies. They're like, we know green screen, we know the effects, we know all those things.
Yeah.
We can help you with that and you'll become an expert at that too. But how can you bring
that story and characters
to our films?
Yeah.
And so, what's your experience in terms of I guess that push pull, like you've done both. Like, do you prefer one over the other?
When you're doing the actual job, when I'm, let's say we're in a scene and we're doing this, whether there's one little camera or 10 big ones,
exactly.
Whether there's 300 people behind those cameras or six,
mm-hmm.
it's, you know, You're supposed to, you got to show up ready mm-hmm. to listen and ready with whatever the other actor throws you to react as your character would, because you've done that, hopefully, study. So that's not very different.
Right.
You know, what can be different, whether it's a big crew or a little crew, is how into the story a crew is, you know? And that does affect you. It affects me anyway as an actor, right? Like, it's like being in a theater and you're doing a play and you can feel in the dark those people. There's an energy. Like, they're listening. They're into your story. It gives
they're
you...
They're your audience.
It gives you wings. It helps you. It pushes you. It makes you do a better job.
I loved you the day I met you. I love you today. And I will love you the rest of my life.
So can I put a P.S. Kiss the Kids?
A P.S.?
Yeah, like at the end.
It's perfect, Tony.
You know, you were talking about the walls. You know, we can't exist. Our society can't mm-hmm. exist if we continue to build walls. That we have to actually, you know, break those walls in order for us to advance, based upon climate change, based upon what's happening in different countries. What I loved also about Green Book was that you actually see those invisible walls between the characters slowly break down.
And ignorance. You break down ignorance through experience.
Yeah.
Together.
And you know, you hear Tony, he's impressed with him when he writes home.
Yeah.
It's the moments separate from their interactions with each other that say the most. And I'm imagining that you had to play some of that stuff without, like, for instance, when he's on stage performing, your reactions to his performance.
Being surprised at what an artist he is.
Yeah. Like, to me, those moments how did you make sure that they came out as unique expressions as opposed to just being reaction shots?
Right. Well, he doesn't know about that music, about classical music. He knows a lot more than Doc does about popular music, including African American, you know, musical stars, Aretha Franklin, Sam Cooke, et cetera. Mm-hmm. As you see in other scenes, he knows more about that. But he doesn't know anything about classical music. So he's just amazed at the guy's skill. So that was just that. And fortunately, you know, between Mahershala and Chris Bowers and the playing.
And he's actually playing Mahershala some of that stuff, right?
Some of it he is, And it was beautiful. Yeah. I wanted to, it was great. It was really fun that there was so much music and that they actually were playing it in a lot of scenes. I don't know how much time we got, but Black Panther obviously made, I don't know what, $1 billion. I mean, it was a huge, huge hit. Does it change the way that you look at, or have you found, like, the way that your fans who are African-American, does it change something in the way they see, do you think? Or you see the movie business or possibilities? I mean, it's not just Black Panther. There's a lot of all kinds of size budgets, movies. This year, for example.
It's a new time.
There are a lot of directors who are African-American. There are casts that are predominantly, or in the case of your movie, almost completely African-American or, you know, African. How do you see something like, is it a sea change? Did Black Panther, how much did that have to do with it, do you think, how people look at it this year?
I think it was already happening because I can point to, you know, the last few years, things have slowly started to happen. You know, Selma,
12 Years a Slave,
Fruitville Station, Moonlight, you know, 42. I can name
a gradual
change of like, you know what? These are quality films. These are great filmmakers. These are good stories.
For a young, like if you're just starting out and you are Black and you are, you know, an actress or an actor,
there are more opportunities now. But I will say that, you know, Black Panther is the confirmation of a lot of that. It was a culmination, and it definitely is a change. I feel now that, oh, people are like, oh, wait. I thought, some people thought that might have just been a fluke or a trend. Mm-hmm. Whereas I think what people are realizing now is that, oh, wow, there is a wealth of
and a market.
There's a wealth and there's a market of stories here. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you leave out, like, if you think about like African history, African American history, and this is probably true of Latino history, mm-hmm. As well. When you leave out a great part of what has made this nation,
yeah,
you know, all of the contributions, you're also leaving out a lot of great stories.
Yeah, yeah.
There are a lot of really, really cool mm-hmm. things that could be, you know, learned and loved
yeah.
by an audience. And people are starting to realize, like, yeah. oh, man, I didn't even know that existed. Like, let's Green tell Book. That story.
Don Green Shirley.
Book. Yeah, it's Don like, Shirley.
You know, some jazz buffs know him, but I think a lot of people are going to discover him as an artist. And it's not like he was gone in the sense that, well, yes, sir, we had a conversation. I brought up Zora Neale Hurston, right? Yeah. Great novel, Their Eyes Were Watching God. Exactly. And she had disappeared. She was a great African-American writer, you know, in the early, mid-20th century. Mm-hmm. And she was gone. And part of it was a male-female thing. It wasn't just a black-white.
Exactly.
It was black writers who were like the big writers, the leaders in the African-American letters. They were like, eh, and they kind of put her down and made her disappear. And it was Alice Walker in the 90s that brought her back.
Right.
And I'm hoping Green Book brings Doc Shirley back
right.
and the Don Shirley trio and his beautiful contribution to jazz, the fusion he did with classical and jazz music. You know, sometimes that happens, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes a legacy is renovated, you know. I mean, maybe with when you did Marshall, it's just one section of his life, but it makes you want to learn more about it.
Right.